before we start, just to give you a brief background of who I am and where I'm from, Gitanjali Bhattacharjee, I represent an organization called Spatial Access. We started 10 years ago as a media audit firm. So essentially all marketing companies, right from a Colgate-Palmolive to a J&J to a Aerolac to an Asian Paints, it's a large business of advertising out there, and all of them spend monies on media. So for creating their ad films on television or their hoardings or their print and digital ads, they spend considerably in terms of media investments. We audit those investments. While we've been doing this for the past 10 years very successfully, we're auditing, we're the leading independent media auditor in the country. We audit over 40% of the TV spend of the country. And while we've been doing this, 5 years ago in 2005, 7, 8 years ago, started a company called Production Performance Monitor, which is when I joined the organization. And my focus at that time, with my background of being on the agency side of the business, the creative agency side of the business, handling a pre-press studio, I had set up a pre-press studio, was to bring to the industry a better understanding from a marketer's viewpoint of what print production can do to your business beyond price. Right? Because every time we're talking to marketers, more and more the questions that are being asked are costs. And the fact is, if you are in the industry and on the other side, you know there's a lot more that's happening in this space that is not just cost sensitive. Therefore, how do you amplify the business and make it relevant to brands? Because brands, marketers are hiring people like us, whether you call them consultants, whether you call them auditors, whether you call them tracking experts, but they're asking questions that they don't have answers to. And those questions are being driven by people who don't understand print production as well as we'd like them. So there is the need for a bridge to translate the language of print production to marketing lingo and make it relevant to those procurement chaps who keep throwing tenders at you and saying, match price karo, make the business name it. So how do you actually sensitize the brand to understand print production the way you'd like them? Because having been in the business, I understand that here's where we are. We've been talking metrics, we've been talking measurement for a long time. Every other industry, I also represent the EMA, which is the event industry, which has been shying away from measuring themselves until last year when they actually launched technology like Snapline, which said to every marketer, you're doing an event, you want to measure the output, here's a technology that's doing it. So the fact is, in the end, everyone's going to ask for measurement. The print industry is the only industry that keeps coming in, going out, taking those steps, and then stepping back, So we've been talking about this for a long time. The fact is, whether the industry aligns to it or not, we are doing it for marketers. I just think it's fair to share and get feedback from, you know, the partners themselves to know whether you're willing to move with the partners in the brand space to develop a model that is more transparent. So I'm captioning this as something which is an ATM, because finally the idea is for it to deliver to us certain returns. And if I was to start with where we are today, what are we really looking at? We don't have a standard metric to measure anything that goes beyond price, right? So you have little bits of measurement of quality, measurement of quantity, but is there a metric? Today, if you want to measure television, you know, you're a Colgate and you've spent X on particular channel, you have something called GRPs. You have TV ratings, which tells you that I put my money on this channel, this is how many people saw that ad, and I know what is the return on my investment. Similarly, when I'm buying a spot, on whether it's a print ad or a radio spot, I have a sense through auditors like us, so what are the buying benchmarks? What is the quality of my buy? Am I getting some spots that are being missed? Am I getting some spots that are running? So there is a metric today that is giving me input, output, and deviation. Right? Ours is the only industry where you don't use the data you have. We are the only country where we are data intelligent. The kind of analytics work that is being done in every other space is so huge, where they're just looking at data points, tossing them up, and making it relevant to everyone who signs in. Right? So if you look at, you know, the Amazons, the Flipkarts, what are they really telling us? Ours is the place where data insights can actually create a lot of value. Because if an online model can be so acceptable in a country where the online penetration is so low, it demonstrates to you that the ability to look at data intelligently is something that we are at. So user analytics and amplification. Another thing I keep telling Ramu, you know, because I'm part of Print Week, I see such amazing work which is being done when I come and judge, I'm part of the jury. When I talk to marketers, again, whether it's MTS Telecom, whether it's, we have 180 advertisers who work with us on an ongoing basis. They keep hiring me to tell them which vendors should we work with. Who are the innovative people in the market? What are the new substrates that I can look at? And frankly, all that data lies with us. There is no reason why we can't put it all together in a manner that becomes relevant to marketers. Why are we holding on so tight to this information? It's something I don't understand. Because there's a large need for marketers to have a filter that gives them these answers, right? We're really growing from doing more of the same thing. That's the way marketers look at it, because you're doing your innovation, but you're not amplifying it. So there are these interesting, you know, developments that happen, but we don't talk about it. While we're doing more of the same thing, this is what's happening out there. Reverse auctions and procurement teams are strengthening the price premise. While you keep saying quality and innovation, because you don't amplify it in the right context, the world out there is still measuring you on price. And I think it's time to cash in on the ATM. So what we're coming here to look at from an ATM point of view is three things. One is building accountability, making all of us accountable for what we do. But before that, we need to know, are we willing to provide answers? Because it's one thing to say, yes, I'm willing to be accountable. But the other thing is when you're asked questions on your models or on what you operate, are you willing to provide the answers? Transparency will be shared data. Something as simple as in a month, you've had 10 new wins, right? You've had 10 new projects. Somebody said they do 350 wedding books in a month. It's very valuable for people who are buying this to have this kind of information. You might be sensitive about sharing price. While you think you're sharing the price, frankly, marketers are sharing the price with us anyway. So I know at what price points you're selling to them. While you're holding on to that price data is available from your buyer. So the point is, if you're willing to open out and share data and say, yes, at least here's what I do, let me share it out, we amplify it, we create a metric, it becomes valuable for yourself, for competition, for everyone else. The entire industry gets elevated. Will we invest in metrics? It's one thing to say, yes, it's a great model, but it's another thing to say, who's going to actually build the technology to drive it? Right? So here's what we're looking at as baby steps, because you can't take that big leap straight out. So how do we get there? The final, you know, the nirvana is really creating a gold standard where you can have a print rating system, a print production rating system. But I think the first step to take there in that direction is to start with a rated database of people, the vendors, the partners, and their projects. Because it's like a directory, right? But it's a directory which has rated information. It's a track that gets shared on an ongoing basis, which really announces your wins, your capabilities, your credibility, and history to people who want to invest and make new partnerships. It's a simple tracking system, which finally leads to a benchmarking practice which is based on data. But that's something that comes at stage two. So what we're really looking at is something called peer track. You must have seen some noise created about it in the print week. That is the ad that was released. It's really a production, exchange, evaluation, and reporting track. Reporting format, right? So PEER, production, exchange, evaluation, and reporting. What it simply does is it allows you on a portal to log in, to share information in a particular format. And at forums like this, we decide which is what is information that you're willing to share at stage one and not willing to share. It's essentially a metric where you upload information. That information gets validated by someone like us. It gets evaluated. It gets created into a system that is more palatable and understandable by marketers. And it becomes an ongoing exchange media. Why is it that this is the only industry where we're not creating the metrics when there is a need?
I think the biggest issue today, I think as a print converters, you know, that majority of the time we are never come across to the brand managers, you know.
Bang on.
Because most of the time, It's only the purchase guy who's talking to us, because I tell you, you know, recently some of the brand managers are with us in our plants. So we just asked them regarding the cost. He said, Sanjeev, cost is immaterial. Who told it that cost? We require this thing, but when we want this thing, there we may be asking who could be the most economical in providing us this thing.
You have hit the nail on the head.
So,
because that is what I'm saying to you. There is no bridge today that talks brand and print production. The only bridge that has happened is procurement.
And I think that is leading only to reverse options.
Correct. And depressing the final industry price. It's not doing anything for anyone. Now, if all of us are going to keep hedging on price and not going to take a leap to say quality comes at a premium, here is how I will measure quality on a rank. I will make quality quantitative. So when you create a ranking system, it's, price is just one of the variables.
Yes. Because I should put like this, that we, the industry has reached to a situation. Like while as a company we are very young, only 7 year old in this industry, but I think in 7 years I have seen the, because of thanks to reverse auction, the prices has gone to an extent. I think nobody has any choice left over that. We have to turn the table now.
That's right.
Because there's no other way. So,
we are very lucky to have David Stenover, a global business director from Paper Tiger. He's just flown in today morning from the US, and he will just share with us a little bit about Paper Tiger.
Chase Corporation is a company based in Boston, and their core business is this stuff here. They do the insulation wrap around cable and wire. So if you put up your telecommunication cable and you look at the silver sort of, you know, wrap around the cable, which will protect it against, you know, water, heat, and so on and so forth, that's their main business, and they are the US's largest producer of that material. And it was from that technology, it led to this technology here, so it's quite an interesting move in technology. We were founded in the States in 1946, that's quite old for an American company, I can tell you. We're a public company, we're quoted in the New York Stock Exchange, we employ, as you say, about 700 people. One of the nice things, in Forbes magazine, we're rated as one of the top 200 in the United States. And that top 200 is really measured on invention, initiative, profitability, all those good things. And I'm happy that we sit in that segment. That plane on the side there, we recently won the contract with Boeing for insulation wrap around Boeing aircraft. A million miles away from the kind of stuff I'm going to be talking to you today. But the similar technology, it's there. It was engineered. It took 5 years to get that contract. Once we actually won the contract, we sold the factory to the company that won the contract with Boeing. So we sold the whole lot because that factory was only dealing with that product after that point. Well, I won't bore you with too much here, but I spend a lot of my time near Boston, which is where we make produce the product. We've got factories various around the globe, including UK and in Holland, and in various parts, including now recently in China. We have strategic partnerships. We're a producer. We sell our product in big rolls, the same way that paper is produced. So that's where we sit in the marketplace. So we're normally at least 3-4 steps away from the final user of the product. We have decided in your market to work with Nimesh and his team. Why are we doing that? Well, a part of the reason why we're doing it is because of his background in speciality and Tyvek in particular. I mean, Tyvek is a product that's been very good to me. It helped put my kids through school, and I love the product. But sometimes Tyvek as a product is over-engineered and overpriced for its purpose. And this company in the States have identified that, and we're actually operating very closely in that segment. Especially the way that print technology is going, is looking for a product more akin to our product, which has a shorter life than a product like Tyvek, which they use it for house wrap, it'll live forever. So it's a different sort of business. If this guy works his suppliers as well as he works his customers, then we will be successful. I think I've got 22 customer meetings in the next 3 days. So that will be an interesting challenge. Where do do we fit? Well, where do we fit? We're a bit of a hybrid. We're not a synthetic, we're not paper. We're paper, film, paper product. It's a laminar product, three-ply laminar product. I've given you in here, this folder, by the way, is made out of paper tiger, so that you know, as far as the little clips here are concerned. And inside, you'll see technical data sheets of the materials, a sample of the materials that we have. And it shows you the construction of the product, and it also shows in a lot of detail. We're getting new swatch books done at the moment. Nimesh will have them soon. The reason we haven't got swatch books is we just changed our paper supplier. Our paper is now supplied out of Brazil. Our core product is 31 gram paper. There's not too many producers of 31 gram paper. So we are limited in the range of markets that we can get to. But as our volumes have built, actually people have come to us, so we've actually recently changed our paper supplier. So in here there's samples of our product, which I'll leave you. And equally in the folder here is a soft copy of the presentation I'm going to give you today. Okay, so it's in there if you want to use it internally. And in here is a hard copy of it. And by the way, this folder is also made out of paper tiger as well. No, 31 paper on the outside, and then you have film on the middle, and 31 paper on the outside. So that proves, so if you've got like a 94 gram product, we'll have 31 gram paper, we'll have a film in the middle, and 31 gram paper on the other side, and that will bulk up to 94 gram. In here you've got 94 gram, 100 gram, 150 gram, 200 gram, and obviously we use higher paper weights to arrive at that point, and higher film weights to arrive at that point. And the heaviest we've got is a 260 gram in our normal product, but there's a C1S in there and there's a C2S in there as well. C2S is becoming much, especially in the packaging market with the digital guys, that's becoming a very much a growing business for us. Where do we sit in the marketplace? Well, as I said, we've got the big boys, we've got the synthetics at the top, and you know, where performance is important. Tyvek obviously sits up there as well, which is a little bit of a hybrid. You've got the heavy-duty papers down here, and you've got us that sit in the middle. So if you're a printer, that you want to print a paper substrate as opposed to but you need to offer your customer a product which is durable, you can print this conventionally. You don't have to worry about inks, you don't have to worry about setups. You're printing on paper. It converts like paper. So you can offer your customer a product which is durable without having to go to offer them a synthetic product, or go to somebody else that can do it for you. So you want to keep your business in-house. You don't want to give it to a specialist printer. And this is why this product's done very well. We're taking quite large slices of business in the United States from the people like Nupo, Polyart, Tyvek, those sort of guys. Technical data sheet, as I say, is inside. The product, the paper we use is FSC paper, which is important. It has a film which is oxy-biodegradable. I'll tell you a little bit about that in a moment to just give you an idea as to what that is and why that's important to us. And obviously our factory is ISO certified. Here we got the oxo-biodegradability. With the advent of film-based products, I think it's been our responsibility that if we're going to put film in the middle, that product should be biodegradable. In certain markets, that's now becoming, markets like parts of the Middle East, that's now becoming legislative that if you're selling a film-based product, it has to be oxy-biodegradable. Why? Because the product will biodegrade naturally, depending on how fast you want it to biodegrade, depending on what the application is. But you know what? A lot of the materials that you guys are printing for signage or anything like that has a short life. You look at forecourt banners, promoting, the price of petrol or gasoline today, that really has a short life, 30 days. And you see them, they're printing it on synthetics or Tyvek, which doesn't have a short life. I mean, this is printed on paper tiger. This will do the job. This product will do outside up to 90 days, it'll be fine. No problem at all. And then after a period of time, if that went to a landfill situation, it would naturally biodegrade over a period of time, depending on how long we want it to live. As we live in the supply chain, we make products, a paper merchant puts it on his shelf, it goes to the printer. The printer might have it on his shelf, and then by the time he gets to the person that's using it, he actually wants it to have a life. So we have an additive in it that basically breaks the product down after 30 months. And I'll show you that if I can.
We see some printed plastic film. When it was being made, a small amount of Symphony's D2W additive was put into the ordinary polymer at the factory. It has become an intelligent plastic. We call it controlled life plastic because it would last for a much shorter time than regular plastic if it gets into the open environment. The normal properties of the plastic are maintained, so flexibility, strength, sealability, printability, and processing speeds and temperatures are all unaffected. The plastic looks and behaves exactly the same as normal plastic until the end of the useful life of the product, which was decided at the time of manufacture. The plastic material which you see here was designed with a useful life of 18 months, but by adjusting the formulation of the D2W, Symphony can program longer or shorter periods of fitness for purpose into the plastic product. Symphony's D2W contains a catalyst that changes the long entangled molecular chains within the polymer, which gives the plastic product its strength and durability. D2W does not contain heavy metals, and the product can be recycled if collected during its useful life, provided, of course, that recycling facilities exist in your locality. At the end of the useful life of the product, the D2W automatically begins to change the molecular structure of the polymer. The process continues on land or sea so long as oxygen is present and will be accelerated by ultraviolet light and heat in the open environment. D2W plastic does not need to be composted. If disposed of in landfill, the process stops in the absence of oxygen and the unchanged material will not emit methane.
That, just to give you an example where there's a one in that, Ford recently sent out their annual report of accounts in the United States in an envelope made of paper tiger. They are obviously have a responsibility to their customer in the cars that they build, and they feel they've got a responsibility all the way through down their value chain. So this was a big chunk of business for one of our customers in the Detroit area. And out of that, the salesman that closed on this, he picked up Chevrolet. I mean, these guys are just like animals. I mean, he made good commission out of it. He liked the product. And we picked up Audi, Mercedes, a lot more in that area. Because they all feel that, you know, it is their responsibility as well. I'll throw these samples on. As I'm at the beginning of the week, guys, don't take them with you, but I'll pass them around because I'm going to be doing this the rest of the week. So I'll take any questions on that later on, but D2W is the additive. The additive is put into the film when the film is produced, so we have qualified suppliers of the film. They have to put in so much into that film, which we get a warranty that that film will last and will not break down until the 30th month. And literally, it's like a trigger. That was not theatrized, that was actual in the way that that breaks down. It'll stay exactly as it is, and all of a sudden, bang, it'll go. Coca-Cola, a lot of plastic bottles now are being made with this additive in it for exactly the same purpose and reason, as you can well understand. I said the product ISO certified. I mean, this is where our product comes to life. It's what really is what it's used for, and the applications where we've been successfully developing. This top level up here, this area here, that material was originally on Tyvek for the first Gillette Marathon ever run, which was the London Marathon in London, obviously. We were asked, at that time I was working with a company called Wiggins Teeth, which is owned BAT, which is now Antalis, and they asked us for a donational material. We gave them Tyvek, and that Tyvek was used for bibs, and that really became the standard for bibs in the industry after that, ironically. Our product here, it prints digitally, beautifully, short run, much cheaper, oxybiodegradable, because quite frankly, that's going to have a life, and beyond that life, it shouldn't just exist. And so it's a big chunk of business for us in the marketplace. there's a company up here, I won't show you the link, but it's on your thing, a company called Rainbow Racing. They're marketing this product, and they take it as an initiative over their competitors in the marketplace. And they've grown dramatically. The bed there is what we call law label. It's law, as we all know, to put information on the mattress to say what's in the mattress. That should be sewn on that mattress, so it's always there for the life of the mattress. Paper Tiger's got a big chunk of that market. We produce a product which has a film which you can sew, and it will get sewn on there. The reason why, again, it's moved to this is because there's equipment out there where we'll print this and we'll personalise it on a short run for that mattress in particular. Sealy is probably one of our biggest customers. Not our customer, but one of our customers' customers. So anywhere where you've got law label, which very often is on a linen-based product or Tyvek or something like that, and that goes from chairs to beds and everything else, Paper Tiger's done extremely well. So we're eating into that market quite nicely. All these are self-explanatory. This product here, obviously, baggage tags is a gimme. That market is a growing market for us as well as, and developing very nicely. Again, a lot of that, we're producing a product at the moment for bars and restaurants and stuff like that. You'll see stuff in there, you'll go into the bars. Frequently it'll be on the laminate product, which the problem is it reflects, and they don't want the reflection, because it reflects with the light, or if you go to the States, there's TVs wall to wall, and they reflect. This is digitally printed. This is digitally printed, as you would expect, inkjet. And so with a lot of this market is now starting to develop into this area quite rapidly. Maps. What a wonderful product. Use maps. Okay. Well, some people have to, because for every commercial or civil aircraft, they can't rely on their iPhone or whatever. It's by law they have to have a paper map in the cockpit, because technology sometimes fails. These maps are used for the FAA, Flight Aviation Authority in the United States. These are, in fact, if you want to pass one, pass them down. The thing I love about these maps is that they are reproduced every 90 days. And it's in a controlled area. So this is not a map of the United States. I'm not quite sure which one this is, but this will be of a state or an area. The reason I have to change every 90 days is because basically the defense corridors get changed every 90 days. So you've got commercial corridors and you've got military corridors. And it's the military corridors which change regularly, for all the reasons we would understand. And the commercial aircraft need to know that they can't go into those areas, because especially at the moment with the amount of activity that's going in certain parts of the world. This was previously printed on polyart. The printer loves it, because before he had product laying all over the place, drying, before he could actually crease it, and as you can see, it creases extremely well. So if you want a durable map, this product will really win every time, as far as I'm concerned. So that does an excellent, and you can see the printability of it as well. This is going digital, by the way. I mean, the FAA have just closed down their print factory. They put the business out now for bid, probably the lowest cost we'll get it. And before they did that, HP qualified our material on a piece of equipment, and therefore those people that's got that equipment will be bidding on the business. But HP did all that work before it got put out, and FAA actually contracted HP to do that work. Instruction manuals, all the usual stuff, I won't delay on that, but it's good. The thing about instruction manuals, which is important, or any manual sort of product that you're looking at, is the product also, for synthetic, you know, drill punching, not a problem. Thermo binding, not a problem. Hot melt binding, it's not a problem. And then folding and creasing is not a problem. So you can get a synthetic product that will do all those type of things, which is important when you need to have it done. The file folder up there is which you've got, that's on Paper Tiger. Envelopes, if you want to secure, send a document securely, then PaperTiger will win over any other. Tyvek is the great, if you want to send a bulky, something heavy in the market, don't use our product. That's where the Tyvek reigns. But if you want to send a document which is important in the post, you want to make sure it's, you know, water resistant, tear resistant, all the things, all the good things that we sell, that's when we win all the time. So insurance companies, we get a shed load of business with insurance companies. One of our customers just won the Wells Fargo in the United States, big piece of business through FedEx, again on a PaperTiger envelope. So PaperTiger wins big time on envelopes, and the envelope guys love it because it folds like paper, it cuts like paper, and it prints like paper. So the envelope guys love it, and the envelopes is a big piece of business we have, obviously, and around this company here, Kaiser Permanente, it's a big insurance company. UPS, well, I think we all know who UPS is. UPS won't send out, obviously, you know, heavy goods in there. They'll be sending out something out there which is bigger. This is the new Wells Fargo one. I think we all know UPS, Priority Mail. This is a product, I love this product. I mean, I bore people to death on this. This is a product to live. You know, you guys are being squeezed all the time. This producer of pad in the United States has got one customer, it's called Staples. He hasn't had a price increase from Staples for about 8 years. Every time he murmurs it, they say, we're going to put it out for bid. He's got one factory employing nearly 300 people that are really living, working for Staples today. So he's forever trying to take cost out of his product. We can only go too far. He got to this top bit here. This used to be on, again, it used to be on Tiger. This top here. He is now on Paper Tiger. You know, he saves himself a nickel and a dime. That's a game. We'll put some value add into the profit, into the business. You've got any, you know, anybody who's producing pads and so on and so forth, much easier for him to produce, much easier product. And, you know, the factory is still going. Oh, this one here is good. I love this as well. This company in California producing wine wanted to sell their product off the shelf. They wanted to get people's attention to their product, selling it off the shelf. They did a lot of tests on this product, obviously to make sure it was durable, soaking it for God knows how long, just to make sure it didn't fall apart. And it's what they do is they sell, they put a wrap around it, and it might be a Halloween wrap, it might be a Mother's Day wrap, it might be a Christmas wrap, so that you buy the bottle and you take it around so it's already wrapped and it's ready to go. The product does really well. They're trying to patent it, but they'll never be able to patent it because it's not patentable. But it's done extremely well and sold for a lot of stores in the United States. Audi send out there, you buy an Audi car these days, and in it, the customer care kit will be in a folder made out of a product. We get a lot of packaging applications, we're moving into a lot of packaging applications. The one at the bottom, Defender, well, this is my sleeve, is made out of the product Defender. And this product I'll go back to in a little while and tell you a bit more about. For the gentleman over here, our product is, if you're going to live in this industry at the moment, as well as obviously the market is there, if you're moving into digital, your product's got to be qualified. So our product has got 3 stars, qualified by HP, as it is qualified by Xerox and Kodak and all the other guys in that frame. But they want to sell more equipment. So if they've got a durable material that will run on their equipment, they want to promote it because it helps them sell more equipment. So that product's certified both sides of the water. In the United States, we sell our equivalent to mention the States is a company called Nina Paper. Nina Paper sell high quality papers. I don't think they're in the Indian market. You may have heard of them, you may not. But they're not a commodity seller. They're here?
Yeah.
And they do extremely well because they don't think commodity because they can't live in that. That's not their business. So that's why they do extremely well in Paper Tiger. They love the product and they do extremely well. Appleton have just taken our product and it's specifically, they call it paper film paper, you know, not terribly imaginative. and you can see the market that they're looking to go into. This is another one of our distributors in the marketplace at the moment. These guys are desperate to stay alive. This company, Appleton, their main business is carbonless paper. Well, we know what's happened to carbonless paper. It's going. So carbonless paper is their core business. So they're trying to reinvent themselves while they've still got customers. And that's a very difficult market to be in. But we're also in that market ourselves because frequently people will take our product and put a CF coating on it or they'll put it into a carbonless form. So Delta Airways, just the last sheet here will be Paper Tiger, and that's the sheet that will go on the outside on the cargo. And they'll have all the data on the outside which they can record and so on and so forth. This is, again, exactly the same thing. It's got a CF coating on the back. These guys are, again, all looking to have a niche, trying to go somewhere they can sell value add, you know, because the regular business, they're all being... I mean, the presentation we had previous, it wouldn't happen in the United States. I mean, just wouldn't happen. I mean, you don't have to sign an NDA just to walk in a building these days. They're all very critical and careful about sharing anything, because nobody trusts anybody, unfortunately. So I welcome your initiative, and I hope you all buy into it, because it's an important one. But this is a good business. Defender. This is the product which is just moving all the time at the moment, and I'm very happy with it. I can tell you a little bit about it, but I'll probably show you a little video in a moment. But basically, does anybody know about RFID? Yeah? Good. Okay. RFID is growing dramatically. The banks are all in denial. The banks are having to produce contactless cards because their customers are demanding them. Starbucks, people like this, they want their customers going in and out. You know, order, touch, grab your cup, and leave. They don't, you know, and you know what? My daughters don't. They don't ask for a paper slip. They don't. They you know, touch. They assume they're going to pay the right amount. They never check their statement, so they would never know. So the amount of foot flow that goes through the Pret-a-Manger and Starbucks and stuff like that. Now London Transport are moving to it as well. They don't want to accept. They don't want cash. They don't want chip and pin. Contactless card. You get on there, you go. Bang. So contactless cards are growing radically, and intelligent cards are growing radically, but there is a huge issue around it. There's a huge theft issue built around it, which I'll show you. We sell a product here, I mean, badges here. Oh, God, you know, you've got your entry badge, it's coded. Anybody can take that code off of that card. I mean, it's so easy to grab the data off of it. So there's data to get an entry, and somebody wanted to grab that information, it's very easy to do. Some companies now demand that you keep your entry card in one of these things, which is tied on your hip here or here, because on the inside of it is our product, Defender. So the data goes in here, so it's protected all the time. Nobody can read it. Activation labels. Somebody will send you a card in the back in the post and say, if you want to activate this and use our credit card, just peel this away. Well, there's live data on there as soon as you peel it away, but they want to make sure before you get it, nobody tampers with it. So that'll be our material on it. You might receive an envelope in the post with a card. You'll think, it, you know, you won't even look at the envelope. It's probably Defender, because they'll make sure when they ship it to you, they don't want any liability with that card. That card can be lifted, it can be skimmed. So there's a lot of industry behind this at the moment which is driving it, and thankfully we're taking advantage of it. Passports, it's an absolute no-brainer. Your passport's alive, it's got a chip in it. You know, when I get land at, if I land at Heathrow now, I go into a scanner. Are your passports chipped? They will do. You know, I get my, I'll show you what I mean. A well-used passport, I tell you. My passport, when I land at Heathrow on my way back, I'll go through a scanner. I put that on the scanner, that's all my details, my pictures and that, and I'll lay that down there, and I'll stand there, and it'll take a photograph of me, and then the doors will open and I'll walk through. They're not getting the data off that, they're getting the data off that little chip there. All my data about me, everything about me is on that chip. Identity fraud is massive. There's an awful lot of people that want to get into the UK and countries like that. You know, we have been queuing up at Calais, trying to find ways of getting across that strip of water. Identity theft is massive. Staples in the United States now, all the big stationery companies are selling sleeves and passport covers now, and they're insisting that anybody that business travel, they should at all times keep their keep this in a cover. If they've got a business card, a company credit card, which is contactless, that should go in, that should be kept in there as well. So that's, we've got tolls, driving licenses, how are your driving licenses now? Are they on a card? Okay, it's chipped. Any card that's issued in the United States now, which is chipped, will come with a sleeve. And it, you're told to put it in it. So gradually we're moving across all the states that are doing it. Medicare, anybody got a Medicare, you know, you've got your, all your information about you on a little, again, it's chipped, it's very easy to get hold of, and you can get that information. So they're being issued with these sleeves. We're also getting into the luggage business, because obviously the other way of getting into it is my wallet has got our material inside this wallet here. So you've got the leather and the leather, if it is leather, probably not. And inside there is our defender, which is our product. So that means when that's folded, then it's protected. So we've got a lot of people jumping. I was in Turkey 2 weeks ago, an envelope company. If you've got to reinvent yourself, if you're an envelope company, you've got to do it quick. And you know, he's making wallets now with our material on the inside and selling them. I mean, this product here, they're going into fashion as well. So they're selling them, you know, fashion value add items that it's got the barrier on the inside again there. So some really nice materials are being produced at the moment. If in the unfortunate event you're arrested in the United States by the FBI, all your possessions are put into a bag made out of our material, including your phone, because even when your phone's turned off, it is still reachable. And they don't want anybody to know where you are or where you're going until they tell them. So everything gets put into a bag made out of our material. That way it cannot be tracked. There's a bucket load of detail on here as far as information that you will need. It's all about frequency. It's not 100% proof, because you've got to make sure the frequency is correct. And all scanners should be set at the correct frequency. We have a situation where some scanners, Marks and Spencers, anybody know Marks and Spencers, the supermarket? They've just accepted contactless cards up to a higher value, actually, because normally they're up to a value of like £30. They increased the limit up to about £50. And they issued a card, Marks and Spencers card, which was contactless. The scanners weren't set correctly, so that when people were paying, all the other cards in either their wallet or their bag were charged as well. So people were getting multiply charged, but people don't know. I mean, they don't check, as I say. Some people do, the smart ones do, but not everybody checks their statement. And that's happened on various occasions these days. So it happened with London Transport, had a similar incident recently. And I've got all the FAQs in there. The questions about this are always the same. So this is just a little bit of a help, that this is a bit of a, you know, if you've got these answers to the questions you're going to get, that will get you through the hurdle. Finally, these guys are still stuck in customs in Mumbai Airport, because I hope you have one on your desk each today. But I want to make sure that we get your names before the end of this session. And my colleagues here are making sure you'll get your paper tiger. Thank you very much.
Thank you.